Okay, now we'll pass on to the next speaker. Giulio Tononi, well known and loved by many of us for his new ideas on information and consciousness. He's originally a psychiatrist trained in Pisa, but then a PhD in neurosciences. Since 2000, he's been professor of psychiatry, consciousness science, and chair of sleep medicine. So today it's about consciousness, it's about sleep and synaptic down selection. As soon as he's ready.
I am. Thank you, Patrick. And I think it's perfect to follow on Yang Dan to talk about function. First, let me thank my collaborators, and first among them, Chiara Cirelli, with whom I have performed all the work I'm going to present today over many years. But I also, of course, need to pay tribute to Nikos and to one of his predecessors, perhaps a very, very illustrious one. I don't know if you can recognize who that would be, but they both look indeed fast and furious. And they both look like with a sort of back to the wall, or to the mast in one case, and both in a caged situation from which they want to escape. And I think, in a way, it's a perfect opportunity for a quote that I truly love about his predecessor. This is from Ulysses of Lord Tennyson. It's worth to read it aloud. "Come, my friends, it's not too late to seek a newer world. Though much is taken, much abides. And though we are not now that strength which in old days moved earth and heaven, that which we are, we are. One equal temper of heroic hearts, made weak by time and fate, but strong in will, to strive, to seek, to find, and not to yield." And I think there is no better motto for describing Nikos. Okay. So in that spirit, and in the spirit of the mystery of the brain, I will address one mystery that has certainly preoccupied myself and Chiara Cirelli for a long time, that is the function of sleep. Why we apparently all need to do that. And it is an enigma that is still essentially unsolved, but it hangs together very much in my mind with the question of the universality of sleep. You heard that Jung presented, you know, the data about now different species sleeping, which is true, but 20 years ago, it wasn't accepted at all. It was known that mammals would sleep, birds would sleep, and for the rest, who knows? So it was an important part of our work to really decide whether focusing on the function of sleep was an important quest or a quixotic one, to see whether it was indeed universal. So we decided to look at invertebrates, specifically the fruit fly, because if it did indeed turn out to be the case that one would have strong proof that they need sleep just as much as we do, then really it would make the case for this universal phenomenon that must have an essential function. And this is just on the left, the first results that show that indeed if you use a lot of different criteria, behavioral, arousal threshold, movement, and so on and so forth, fruit flies of any different line indeed sleep. They sleep almost as much as we do. And importantly, if you keep them awake, they need more sleep. There is a homeostatic regulation of sleep. They also have all other things that are interesting. Same gene expression patterns in sleep and wake across the brain. They do respond to caffeine, and they do respond to antihistamines the other way around. So many things are conserved. Young flies sleep a lot, so everything is very similar. And if you then use the fly as a genetic model, you find that indeed, that was the first mutant we found. It's called Shaker. It's a potassium channel mutant. They have a very disrupted sleep down to an hour and a half, and now they have several more mutants that belong essentially to the same mechanistic system. Those are disrupted behaviorally from the point of view of memory and even survival. So now it's a broader slide than what you saw before to illustrate that indeed, now many groups have shown sleep in other invertebrates down to the flatworm, aplysia, you name it. In essence, there has not been a single species now that has been studied carefully that would not satisfy some criteria for sleep. The most important one being behavioral your irresponsibility. So it's not so much just movement. You can see the exception over there, the dolphin, that still moves around but sleeps one hemisphere at a time, which to me is strong proof that nature really didn't get rid of sleep because it couldn't, okay? And so they move, but they sleep one hemisphere at a time. So if it is universal, then one more reason to wonder about an essential function, because of course sleep presents an opportunity cost, number one, you don't forage, you don't mate, and number two, it's a dangerous state precisely because of its defining characteristic, which is to be disconnected on the input and the output side from the outside world. And so why would you several hours a day, all your life, be disconnected from the outside world, potentially becoming a prey and not doing anything more useful? So that is the question. That is why we believe there is a fundamental function, together with many others that sleep has acquired over evolution and natural selection. And you know, the synaptic homeostasis hypothesis, abbreviated as SHI, proposes one possible answer to this essential function, and that is, it is the price for plasticity, where plasticity undoubtedly is a totally universal phenomenon. It's fundamental for the brain to adapt to a changing environment. So really, it couldn't be more fundamental than that. And here is the sketch of the basic story behind the prediction of SHI, which is that overall, there should be an increase in synaptic strength and many other things, but synaptic strength primary, across the brain. That's a human brain, in red would be the overall net increase. And then sleep is needed to renormalize that synaptic strength and needs to do this in a disconnected state. To have a general idea about the function of sleep, we really need to have an idea of why we would need to disconnect, and we can't just do it when we are awake, maybe quietly so. So here, very quickly, is the logic behind SHI that led us then to perform the experiments, that learning should occur in wake. It should happen primarily to synaptic potentiation, that leads to a need for renormalization of synaptic strength, that should happen primarily during sleep when we are disconnected from the environment, and finally, that this should restore the brain. I won't be able to give you the full rationale, but I'll sketch through it with the slide I usually make use of, which is when you go to a new place, for instance, or even an old place that you revisit, starting from what is obviously not a blank slate, it's a bunch of connections throughout the brain, you see new buildings, new places, new people, or old people who have changed a bit, and so on and so forth, and all of that inevitably is going to leave a trace in your brain, and that trace must be there because that's, of course, how not only we amass memories, but we adapt our own structure in the brain to the structure of the environment. And this you want to do when you're awake, when you're actually learning about the world around you, not learn your fantasies when you're dreaming. That's a very basic thing, but we should keep that in mind. Now, the other thing that we should keep in mind is the amount of learning, even if it's not called academically learning, that's going on all the time. This is a slide taken from the work of the group of Oliva, in which they just checked thousands of arbitrary slides presented to subject during the day, and then they tested recognition memory. And basically, you get almost 90% correct, very often also for trivial details that were present in the image. So no really good study has been done so far to look at the limits of memory, what actually leaves a trace in our brain every day. Sometimes this is called incidental learning, but for sure, we all know it. At the end of the day, there will be a lot of stuff that has stained our brain with memories, or at least synaptic changes, which we may not particularly care about. And so the idea, though, is that whenever you learn, while in principle you can use any mechanism for plasticity, the one that matters in our brain is primarily potentiation. And the reason why I won't go through, here I indicate that that's typically favored by noradrenergic systems being active in other neuromodulatory systems during wake, which they are. But the reason is because since firing, generally speaking, is more energy consuming than not firing, we know that basal firing rates for most neurons, especially excited neurons, are low. And then on that low background, what you want to do to signal is increase your firing. And what you want to do to imprint memories in the brain such that they percolate throughout the brain is strengthen connection, not weaken them. Otherwise, they couldn't percolate. It's very easy, but it's also very basic. Now, if that is so, if there is a net increase in synaptic strength to actually acquire memories throughout the brain, well, that presents a problem that was recognized long ago. For instance, von der Maas' work a long time ago clearly saw that if you have a neural model of some sort, if you potentiate and acquire memories, well, at some point you're going to have runaway potentiation, you just potentiate everything, and loss of selectivity, which is the opposite of what you want for memory. So you must do something about it. Except the default idea was that you probably do it by a mixture of potentiation and depression when you're awake. Why not? The system will find its balance. But we think that that is not the right logic. We think that you actually should do this down selection of synapses, or renormalization of synapses, as we call it, when you are offline. Not only because there may be some incompatibility between potentiating and depressing while you're online, but when you are online, you are a prisoner of the here and now. You are in this environment, you must learn these things. But this is not a good sample of all the things you know. And so what we think must happen during sleep, and we can just model this theoretically, is during sleep, you disconnect from the environment so that you can reactivate your brain in all kinds of ways, not a prisoner of the circumstances here and now, but actually sampling comprehensively and fairly most of your memories, most of your knowledge, so that on that ground, you can decide, so to speak, your brain can decide what to keep and what not to keep. And you do this when the neuromodulators are down, for example, the locus coeruleus, which we hypothesize would implement a reversal of the direction of synaptic plasticity. So that's the basic idea, the formulation of why sleep would be universal and necessary. And the consequence of this idea can be demonstrated in models. One of these, at the system level, is that, well, we know from lots of experiments now in humans and animals, many were performed by Jan Born here in Tübingen, we know that sleep is essential for memory acquisition, even more than consolidation. Without sleep, you cannot really learn new things much at all. Consolidation, integration, gist extraction and insight, protection from interference, and even things like, we now suspect, smart forgetting, keeping what matters, getting rid of the rest, and dealing also with the plasticity-stability trade-off, which is a problem everywhere in brain as much as in artificial intelligence, the idea that you want to keep your memory and not wipe it out for every new thing that you learn, but at the same time, you want to be able to learn new things and integrate them with the old ones. So models show that a down selection during sleep can achieve all these goals. You don't just learn by rehearsing, you actually down select. And then this would give rise to lots of benefits at the cellular level and the system level. The memory benefits, but also benefits, since Jung mentioned that, to the cell, to its burden of, you know, energy use and cell repair and so on and so forth. So I will stop with the rationale, because if the rationale weren't supported by the data, I wouldn't be here talking to you. And I'll just go through data collected over the years. And for us, it was essential to focus not just on one model or on one particular ways of demonstrating synaptic strengthening and weakening, but many of them. Because if sleep is indeed universal and that is a universal function, it should sort of vary in terms of the specific mechanisms, but not in terms of the end result. And so, for instance, one of the studies we did early on was take advantage of the fruit fly and use a marker, Bruch-Pilot, which is a presynaptic marker, which is a very faithful indicator of the strength of presynaptic connections. And you see on the right the entire brain of a fly who had been awake for several hours, and on the left, a fly who had been asleep. And that's generally speaking the rule. There's a net upregulation in wake and downregulation in sleep, this time at the presynaptic level. Now let's move postsynaptically. This is AMPA receptor. So on the left, it's our old studies which first tested this in the cortex and hippocampus of rats. And we saw that there is a big increase in AMPA receptor in synaptoneurosomes, so in the synaptic compartment, in animals who had been awake, and the net decrease, almost 50%, in animals who had been asleep. And on the right, you see a much more sophisticated study performed by Deering in the group of Huganier, in which using many more markers and all the phosphorylation sites, etc., on AMPA receptors, they confirmed that there is a net increase of AMPA in wake in the cortex and net decrease in sleep. There are other papers now that confirm that. Well, we also want to have some electrophysiological markers. Here you see two examples. On the left, in rats, you can see that the slope of the field potential after electrical stimulation goes up after 4 hours of wake, from wake zero to wake one, and goes down in the same animal after 4 hours of sleep, from S0 to S1. Now, that's true in animals. It's true in humans, albeit more indirectly. There we use TMS to induce a strong pulse and then measure with high-density EEG the response of the brain, and that response becomes steeper and bigger the longer you stay awake, here even including sleep deprivation, and it's only through sleep that the response is renormalized back down. Now, for the past several years, we tried to get, in addition to these and other experiments, to what we might want to call the ground truth. We wanted to get down to the level of synapses, actually morphologically, because if that's what sleep does fundamentally to the brain, decreasing synaptic strength, we should see morphological markers. Now, this took a long, long time, and we're still doing it largely manually. We focused, you see this on the right side, that's the ultrastructural level, and on the left, the red, is the apposition zone between the presynaptic terminal with the vesicles and the postsynaptic spine. We can measure this carefully in these images, which we reconstruct from a volume of tissue, thanks to the instrument essentially perfected by Denk that allows you to do block phase imaging. You reconstruct all those dendrites, you reconstruct an axon passing through, you reconstruct where the axon contacts the spines, and we can get the red zone, which is the apposition zone, and we can measure it precisely. And this was the first set of results we obtained. This is primary motor cortex and primary sensory cortex, layer 2, of adolescent mice. And you have three typical groups we use: animals who have been spontaneously awake, extended wakefulness in which they stay awake a bit longer by playing around with novel objects on a running wheel, and then animals who instead have been spontaneously asleep at the same circadian time, so we can control for various effects. And of course, the groups are primarily awake or primarily asleep, although it's never perfect. And then we measured manually, and it was 4 or 5 years of work for lots of students, all these apposition zones, over 170 dendrites and more than 8,000 spines, most of which, but not all, were actually synapses, meaning there was a presynaptic terminal. And then we just counted the size. Every point is the size of one of the synapses in the three groups. You can see by eye that there is a decrease in the average size in the sleep group. That decrease is roughly by 18% against the two waking condition. And I just want to remind you, we really had no idea beforehand of how much net change there would be in the brain after a day of wake, in this case, several hours of wake in the case of a mouse. And it's a huge change. It's almost 20% of the overall strength that goes up and down. So there's a lot of staining and destaining going on between wake and sleep. The distribution of the synapses in the cortex is log normal, and the log curve shows it very well. And basically what sleep does, it shifts it to the left. It's mostly a scaling. A synapse goes down proportionally to how big it is. But for the bigger synapses we found in cortex, actually, that doesn't seem to be a scaling. They seem to be preserved. Although this is done at the population level, we cannot tell with this technique what happens at the single spine level. Now, recently, we also obtained the data from a hippocampal region, CA1, and an estratum radiatum. And you can see the same three groups. And what happens here? Well, the situation is interesting. Well, the number of dendrites is roughly similar, number of spines is roughly similar. There are differences between the typical dendrite in the cortex at these primary areas and the hippocampus. In the hippocampus, the first thing you notice is that there is a bimodal rather than log-normal distribution of synaptic strength. The bulk is small, and it's log-normally distributed, presumably, and then there is another population which is stronger. The axes are smaller than in the cortex, so synapses are a little bit smaller, but they are denser. Okay? So there are interesting differences. We could say more about it. But The important thing to say here is that we can sort of morphologically identify the two groups based on this larger one tend to be perforated. As you can see on the left, discontinuous postsynaptic density, they have spinulae, they have spine apparatus. So on these bases, we can really separate the two populations morphologically. And when we do that, we see that the end result is in the hippocampus too, after sleep, the size of synapses goes down for both populations. In the small population, non-perforated, the number two goes down, which wasn't happening in cortex. And for the large population, they go down under both conditions. So in the interest of time, I'll just speed through the third important piece of this puzzle we want to address, meaning, well, is this true not only across different brain regions and different species, but also across different phases in development? We sleep even more when we are young, but many things are different. What about synaptic down selection? So we looked at pups. They're very difficult to study. They sleep 50% of the time, so we can't really have long periods of spontaneous wake. But we did the same thing by coloring them, videoing them, scoring them with their mother, and so on and so forth, and measuring, once again, the synaptic apposition zone. We got 136 dendrites. Here we are around 3,000-4,000 spines. There are differences again. Just out of curiosity, you can see that they are less dense than in the adult, and the others are also smaller. But the final result is the same. This is cortex, primary motor cortex, like in the adult, and the distribution is log normal, but what sleep does is produces a shift to the left. And the interesting thing is that this shift is even bigger. So in adolescent mice, the decrease after sleep was on average 18%. Here it's on average 34%. And there is no indication that the bigger synapses, which are not as big as in the adult, are actually protected. They seem to all go down roughly by the same amount. So the last piece of evidence I'll give you, which is still unpublished, is an attempt to look at the synapses individually using two-photon imaging with repeated measures of surface Glu-A1 AMPA receptors in individual spines in vivo upon multiple recordings, while the animals are actually performing a specific learning task, which we call complex wheel learning, that we spent quite some time to show is sleep-dependent and it involves a particular area of cortex, that is, including M1. So here we could image, I won't go through the technical ways of doing this, but both the structure and the surface AMPA receptor, so we can really quantify them for a particular piece of spine or dendrite. And we go through a pre-sleep period, that is, they sleep before the training happens, then the training happens with the complex wheel, then they have post-training sleep, and the other group, instead of having sleep, actually is kept awake, playing around, doing nothing particular, to see whether it's really sleep that's needed or it's just the passage of time. And the end result, you can sort of read it there. Same story. The size of synapses tends to go up in wake. It goes up a bit more in M1 if you are doing a training task and specific synapses change that weren't changing before. But then they go down in sleep, whether it's before or after the specific training. And this decrease requires sleep. If the animal stays awake, the synapses don't go down. By the way, this is now really adult mice, greater, you know, older than 2 months. So we have pups, we have adolescents, we have adults. The same thing happens throughout. I'll skip this in the interest of time. And I will just summarize then this part by saying that overall, synapses are potentiated during wake and down-selected during sleep in different ways. We have molecular, electrophysiological, and ultrastructural evidence for this in different species, from flies to rodents to humans, at different ages, pups, adolescents, and adults, and in different brain areas, including M1, S1, and CA1. We are trying other areas, but it's rather painstakingly, and beyond the point, it becomes boring. So I want to switch to the second part and to talk a little bit more electrophysiology in this audience. So if there is a down selection going on during sleep, are there some other interesting inference one can make about what is known about sleep? Now, you heard already a little bit the description of the non-REM, REM, and non-REM is most of sleep. There are a few things to know about the slow waves that we didn't know 20 years ago. The first thing is that the slow waves that are the hallmark of non-REM sleep travel. They travel. We saw this first in humans, but they also travel in animals, and now been confirmed many times. So a wave starts here, and then it expands in this direction, and then here, and then in that direction. And this is roughly once a second, both in humans and the animals. Second, they are local. This was also not known. So you see here, this is a recording we did with Itzhak Fried in, and Yuval Nir was the postdoc at the time in the lab. We looked at human neurons, individual neurons, in different brain areas. Here, left posterior cingulate against right posterior cingulate. You can see the spiking of the neurons. And then during a local slow wave, on the left, there is an off period. The neurons stop firing. But that's not happening on the right. And 2 seconds later, it happens on the right. And if you do this in general, you'll find out that basically, if this patient has roughly 10 shafts each, in these 10 regions that we were sampling, most of the time, the slow wave was local to one or two regions, and very rarely did it involve the majority of regions. So while sleep is a rather global phenomenon, behaviorally for sure, it's locally very, very different in the brain, and I think there is a reason for that. I want to show you also some other things we learned over time, which is this local slow wave are not just happening locally during non-REM sleep, they happen during REM sleep. Here, we demonstrated that in layer 3 and 4 of primary areas, both sensory and motor, during REM sleep, when the rest of the cortex is activated, you actually have slow waves. And we believe that these slow waves at the entry of sensory stimuli into the cortex are probably crucial as a mechanism for disconnecting the brain, which is an essential part of sleep, as I said. This is not true for higher order areas. Now, the mechanisms of these slow waves, apart from the brainstem and hypothalamic regulation that we heard about, what happens in cortex? What triggers these slow waves in cortex when the neuromodulatory milieu is appropriate? Well, a key player, I think we're able to show, is somatostatin positive Martinotti cells. We are not 100% sure it's only Martinotti cells, but strongly suspect that, which fire just before a slow wave, inhibit powerfully, largely through GABA B mechanisms, everybody else, so every other cell type, and they produce this off period of a few hundred milliseconds. And so that, we could show, produces the something that looks very much like an off period, while parvalbumin neurons, for instance, don't do that, and we are still evaluating neurogliaform neurons. But if you do systemically with DREAD, with chemogenetic stimulation, or deactivation, as you heard before, we actually do, but just acting on cortex, produces strong enhancement, respectively decrease in slow wave activity. Now, the last thing I want to say, the one that most matters here about slow waves, is that they are homeostatically regulated. We have known for a long time, this is the work of Alex Borbe in Zurich, that the slow activity is high when you go to bed and then decreases exponentially in the course of sleep. Well known, well described, true also in animals and so on. You can see this here in humans. It's a map of slow activity power, essentially. First, second, third, fourth sleep cycle, it goes down exponentially. And this is true for every brain region. And then if you keep a human or an animal awake, it goes up even more when you go to bed, and if you take a nap, it goes up less. So very much suggests some growth or decay process of an exponential nature, and that's just phenomenology. But what could be the mechanisms? So Shai essentially made the conjecture that sleep slow activity is both a reflection and an effector of synaptic renormalization. The reason being very simple. If synapses are stronger, everything else being equal in the cortex, neurons will synchronize more strongly, and the waves you record within local field potential, or EG, is going to be bigger and steeper. If synaptic strength goes down in the course of sleep, then they'll synchronize less well, and therefore the waves will be less steep and less big. So we can model this. I won't go into this at all, but it's actually a very nice example of a homeostatic circuit playing plasticity and activity against each other. The more activity you have, the more you down-select during sleep, if the slow waves are also instrumental in bringing about down-selection. And then the waves become smaller, and finally you reach a set point in which the brain is done with the work of sleep, when these waves are small enough that they are not able to drive synapses down anymore. So that's the computer model. We did large-scale modeling of that, but is it true? So first, some evidence from rats. One of the many experiments was to give them a very enriched environment for the same duration awake. This produces many things in the brain, more FOS, more NGFIA, but also more BDNF in the cortex. And when you do that, you see, let's say, proportionally to how much BDNF goes up, which is usually a marker of plasticity happening, you also get more slow activity when the animal goes to sleep. So it's not just the duration awake, it's also the intensity awake. Another corollary is that if you learn something that involves some particular circuits in the brain especially strongly, of course it involves lots of places, but some especially strongly, like in this rotation learning task, where you're not even conscious that you're learning, but your brain is, especially this region here, well, then that region, when it goes to bed, would need more sleep. Synapses are stronger, slow wave should be bigger. And that is indeed the case. It's locally the case. It also correlates with improvement after sleep. Conversely, this is non-physiological, but if you immobilize an arm, and therefore you don't give much opportunity for this inevitable potentiation in the course of the day, then, in this case, contralateral sensory motor cortex shows reduced slow wave activity when you go to sleep. So clearly these slow waves can be a good marker of synaptic strength. They behave according to how you presumably have modified synaptic strength with consequences on behavior. In fact, we are trying to use them clinically now. This is work done in collaboration with Melanie Bolli in epileptic patients. So if you look at epileptic patients and you look at their sleep with high-density EEG, you can actually figure out very well where the epileptic focus is, because that piece of cortex, to the extent you can use EEG for source localization, has an increased amount of slow waves, suggesting that there is a too much potentiation and presumably of a maladaptive kind, of course, due to the tetanic stimulation that the brain gives to itself. So you can see that, and during the night, you can see that the interictal spikes, which are not seizures, but they are strong firing at the neuronal level, very strong, that presumably is so strong, we suspect that they may even induce potentiation when the neuromodulatory milieu is wrong. Well, those interictal spikes interfere with the exponential decline of slow wave activity. And in fact, there is a good correlation between the presence of interictal spikes during sleep and the learning abilities and even the IQ of the patients. So it's also a suggestion to clinicians of a very difficult question to ascertain whether these interictal spikes are a sign that you have epilepsy, but they may not do anything wrong. Instead, it looks like they actually do something wrong by counteracting down selection. So I will have no time to do what I would have loved to do, and that is review recent work by other groups that actually looks at the specific mechanisms that would bring about down selection. So why would activity in these waves that are characterized by firing and silence, because so-called up and down states, or on and off periods at the extracellular level, why would they bring about down selection? Let me just say that both for slow waves and also now for hippocampal ripples, there is evidence that activity in a sleep-like neuromodulatory milieu tends to produce synaptic depression. And except for synapses that are particularly strong or recent, that may seem to be protected. They don't really get stronger, they just get protected. Everybody else gets weaker. There's also some very, very nice work from several different groups that's looking at the molecular mechanisms. For instance, Deering has shown that a key role is played by HOMER 1A that gets sequestered into the spine and can do its job of down-regulating the AMPA receptors only when noradrenaline and adenosine go away. When noradrenaline goes away, then you can actually have the down selection during sleep. A similar role, we suspect, is a G-protein GSK3B and probably ARK. But again, I will not have time to deal with that. I want to reserve my last few minutes to mention something for the future, really, something which we don't understand, but we are trying to address, which is, well, I said it's fundamental for memory for all the reasons I said this down selection. But it's also fundamental at the cellular level, because stronger synapses consume more energy, requires more supplies, they produce cellular stress, and of course, on top of other things, they saturate the ability to learn. So is something happening at the cellular level that is maladaptive if you are not allowed to sleep? And so there are many things that happen. Since we heard, you know, damage to the cell, for instance, one thing we show of the many is that wake produces and sleep repairs double-stranded DNA breaks. Whether this is connected to the plasticity or not, we don't know, but it certainly happens. And there are accumulation neurotoxic levels of glutamate if you don't sleep, and lactate, and so on and so forth. So many things. I want to focus on one, that is what we call local sleep. And here is the original demonstration in which we showed with Wiesowski that if you record with laminar probes in the cortex, say frontal and parietal, of a rat who has been awake just 2-3 hours longer than normal, you begin to see brief off periods that look very much like the ones in non-REM sleep, just shorter, when the animal is awake, eyes open, running around, doing tasks. And they happen in one region, say frontal, but not parietal, and vice versa. But now it's in wake, so you couldn't tell from the animal behavior. Now, this happens more often after sleep deprivation, and if it happens in the wrong place at the wrong time, say in primary motor cortex when the animal is performing a skilled movement, which is reaching for a sugar pellet, it actually disrupts behavior. So these are actually causally relevant in probably some of the silly things we do when we are sleep deprived and our brain goes into local sleep. It does indeed happen in humans. On the left, you see work we did in the past, one of the studies we did, showing that if you do 24 hours of talking and listening only, or 24 hours of driving in a driving simulator only, you start having, presumably off periods based on the animal work, that is little theta waves locally, primarily in Broca and Wernicke areas when you do a lot of talking and listening, and primarily in parietal occipital areas when you do a lot of driving. So something is happening to our brain. It bubbles up with this local sleep episode that are probably not good. And in recent work that we finally published with Yuval Nir, again in collaboration with Itzhak Fried, you can see that even if you go in the medial temporal lobe and find these super selective neurons that respond to specific faces and places and so on, if you actually tire them by training them a lot during the day, specifically that neuron, okay, you show that face, that face, that face, that face, then those neurons during wake begin to fail. They begin to fire later, they have brief periods of silence, and you actually have a behavioral consequence of that, so you have lapses. Now, I said we don't know what goes on. It looks like neurons literally get tired when they don't get enough sleep, and possibly they cannot have down selection. So we are beginning, and I'm more than happy for additional suggestions. One thing even more boring than counting spines and sizes of spines is to count the number of presynaptic vesicles at a spine at that particular distance. So we did that with a German student, and that led to, he insisted he really wanted to see whether that was true. So in the hippocampus, we don't know in cortex yet, that was true. After extended wake, the number of synaptic vesicles that are near the release, ready to be released, actually goes down, as if there were a problem having them readily available. Is this going to give rise to synaptic failure? We don't know, but it's interesting. And other things change. Here's, again, it's just electron microscopy. The astrocytes around the synapse, when you have been awake for an extended period of time, really envelop the synapse much more, as if the neuron might need extra help. We don't know for what. Is it getting rid of glutamate? We don't know that. The other thing that happens in the astrocyte is you look at the glycogen granules. Yes, we measure those too. And it turns out, this is only recently known, that what counts for the release of energy from glycogen, which is all stored in glia, is the surface of the granule. And after extended wake, that surface is actually reduced. So essentially, also the energy reserves in the astrocytes for the neurons go down after extended wake. So I want to end just by saying that the mystery indeed does continue, even if sleep may have a crucial role for an essential function, that is for plasticity in terms of down selection. Why neurons get tired, maybe glia gets tired, is something we still absolutely don't know. So it's something for all the young people to think about. Thank you.
That's very nice. We have time for some questions. Yes?
Giulio, you make the argument of the case that during the day we are bombarded by millions of stimuli around us. The afferentation from the body is very powerful, so we build up a tired system. And we have to disengage from the sensory and motor parts of the world. But this is exactly what we are doing during thinking and imaginations. So why can't we use imagination for downscaling?
So I didn't really spend too much time on that. But the important thing is this comprehensive sampling that only sleep affords. So when you are thinking, and I'm sure that's true in your case, as much as in mine, we're usually obsessively ruminating about something that interests us. And if that were to drive the overall down-selection process, even if you could down-select during wake, that would be very bad. While during sleep, as revealed by dreams, which sort of tells us what's going on, by the way, two-thirds of sleep you dream, not just during REM sleep. So because of that, you really can sample all your old memories, mix them up in all kinds of strange ways. And that's exactly, at least in computer simulation, but it sort of makes sense, the way you can decide what to keep and what to get rid of based on your entire knowledge base and not just the present concerns as well as the present environment.
Other question? Yes?
As it sounds, basically, we all know that we recall information during sleep, and it can be shown for place cells, for any other cells, and your hypothesis will be it's not for making LTP, like we would think, basically, yesterday, listening to talks, but to make memory, but to do LTD, to scale down. Or would you say it's preserving LTP, which was formed during awake, and this LTP doesn't need any potentiation anymore? Or how do you just take this part into your theory?
Yeah, so the theory is reasonably clear about this. For the reason I briefly explained, we would want the important stuff to be preserved and the rest to be gotten rid of, okay? But we wouldn't want, in the first place, to learn new things during sleep, because that's not the time where you want to learn. You want to learn when you're exposed to the environment. And you want a cumulative process of getting rid of all the garbage, not just in 1 hour or in one night, but across many, many days, which is what sleep does. It's an optimal way to actually preserve what matters and get rid of the rest based on a gigantic sample of statistics of your encounters with the environment. Now, that's the theory. We don't know yet. We know there is a net increase in wake and a net decrease in sleep. I think I gave you evidence, and it's true in many species, etc. There is some evidence that some synapses, maybe they are tagged as particularly important, maybe they are just recent, so there are all these complex effects in the memory literature, may be preserved, while others may not be. So that I'm sure that the brain is actually pretty smart about this. There are many other aspects, like the traveling directions of the waves, the difference between early and late sleep, that suggest that the strategy may be much more elegant than simply going down. However, while there may be even some synapses that get strengthened during sleep, and obviously there are synapses that get weakened during wake, that is certainly true, it's not exclusive, I think the logic suggests this general picture, which I hope to have demonstrated.
Okay, thank you. 15 minutes for a coffee break. Don't forget the guest book, and thank you again for a fabulous speech.